So good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to my panel members. I'm so happy to have Pakistan joining us in this discussion today. So let me actually reflect and point to the fact that today, this week and today in particular, is very momentous for Sri Lanka. And it is momentous for Sri Lanka because we celebrate not only this week, the International RTI Day, but this exact day is the end of the five-year term of the first RTI Commission of Sri Lanka. So that, I think, is quite momentous. And also, I think it is a time to look back, to reflect on, the successes and challenges that we have faced during the past 5 years. In certain respects, I think it is extraordinary. The whole RTI experience and the RTI process in Sri Lanka has been extraordinary in the sense that when the law was enacted, it was not, as many of you may know, it did not come from the community, as it were. You know, it was brought together for a period of 14 years by dedicated, committed journalists, activists, civil society, by editors, lawyers who got together and said, we must have this law for Sri Lanka. So finally, when the law was enacted in 2016, our effort was to somehow make it as good a law as possible. At that point, we said, if a bad law is sought to be enacted, we don't want this. We want a good law. If not, then we don't need a law at all. So as a result of our efforts, and as Toby's ranking also shows, theoretically, the law has been ranked quite high globally on the various standards that he spoke about here. Now, but often in Sri Lanka, we have had the experience of having good laws, but very bad practice. We have extremely positive, progressive laws in our statute books, but we don't have them used by citizens, and we don't have the state upholding those laws. And I think Javed would probably agree with me in this regard, that the law itself has been really reduced to, in a sense, a mockery in Sri Lanka for so many years. And this is not owing to a particular political regime or a particular political period, but successively in Sri Lanka, we have had this problem. So to our mind, RTI should have been and was projected as an exception to this practice of bad laws, or not bad laws, good laws, but bad practice. And I think the last 5 years has shown us that, in fact, RTI has lived up to its name. As a commissioner, for example, the most inspiring experiences I have had when, not so much the people who we categorize as the elite, but ordinary people from the, the war-affected areas of Mulai Thiwu to the very distant southern climes of Hambantota or Ebelipitiya, come to the commission, come to the public authorities with the copies of the Sinhala and Tamil Acts in their hands. And they say, we have suffered injustice, we want this remedy. So it's very powerful to see that manifestation of authority in a country which has had decades of war, and where to speak up against authority and against the state would mean reprisals, would mean, somebody reacting against you. And the culture of fear has long been inbuilt into our people. So to see that being overset and overturned really by RTI is, I think, the biggest acknowledgement and the biggest mark, or the biggest, the thing we should be most proud of, I think, after 5 years of RTI in Sri Lanka. So now the other issue that I would like to emphasize here is that when we talk of release of information, it has not been only the release of information here. It's been also the empowerment of communities to speak up, to correct what is wrong in their villages, in their areas, be it a simple thing like electricity or water, or elephants raiding their villages and they have no way to stop them, garbage disposals, perhaps simple service functions, but in a country where the systems are broken, and let me be very, very direct about saying it, the systems are broken, RTI has served as a tool or as a weapon to really remedy that injustice. So in many instances, we have seen the cases going from a simple release of information to the actual problem being rectified. So for example, where corruption is challenged in a particular area where the roads have been badly built, or where the tanks have been, tanks are leaking. It's not only the exposure of that particular corruption that happens, but again, the tanks are rebuilt, the roads are remade, when children are not admitted to schools because of a corruption in the admitting process, and RTI discovers that and exposes that, the children, then the correct children are admitted to schools. In police stations where the police don't take action on a complaint and you file an RTI asking why that is, the police then investigate the complaint. So it goes beyond the issue of the simplistic issue, as we may say, of releasing information. Now, Toby mentioned the three principles, you know, on the basis of which political accountability and RTI could be assessed. And I think in our act, if you look at the practice of as opposed to the theory or as compared to the theory, so the public authorities, who is the act, who does the act include? Public authorities in Sri Lanka come from the highest office of the president down to the lowest, humblest municipal authority. And theoretically, this was predicated or theorized really to say that accountability should be uniform. It should extend at all levels of the state as well as non-state. The Sri Lankan Act, I think, is a little bit different to many other laws, even in the region, because we have also included private entities, certain corporate entities, even non-governmental organizations are included within the Act. And the patterns that we have seen the last 5 years have been that though the Act has been used very much against the state authorities and to a certain extent against corporate entities as well, the extension of that to other areas has been not very evidenced, you know, which is perhaps a weakness that we should correct going forward. Now, as we go out of our term, it will be interesting to know that we have actually recommended that political parties be brought within the Right to Information Act, because I think that's a significant lacuna in the Act currently, and that should be remedied. Now, where the exemptions are concerned, again, a method of assessing how RTI, you know, has impacted on political responsibility and accountability, two exemptions, which Toby also mentioned. One is, of course, cabinet memorandum exemption, and the other one is national security. Now, in the practice of the commission's orders, we have interpreted and applied both exemptions very, very narrowly. And there are very specific orders of the commission in this regard. So, for example, where national security is concerned, there was a very prominent case where a procurement issue, which concerned the building of the defense headquarters of Sri Lanka, and there was a question of corruption in the procurement process, in the monies paid to the architect who had undertaken the building of the headquarters. And the government, the Attorney General at the time representing the cabinet of ministers against whom the appeal was filed, came to the commission and said that, look, this is a matter of national security. And the commission at that point took the position that no, it is not, because the issue here is purely and simply a question of procurement. So national security is really not involved in the process, and therefore we cannot take that exemption on its face value. And one good tool that we have used, which perhaps may be of some interest to other countries in the region, has been the provision of the Right to Information Act that we put in at the start, which allows the commission to call for documents which public authorities refuse to release publicly based on certain reasons. So we are able to examine the documents and then find out for ourselves to what extent the exemptions are applicable or reliable. So in this particular case, for example, when national security was alleged, we called for the Cabinet Subcommittee report under Section 15, which gives us the statutory power to call for that. And we examined the report of the Cabinet Subcommittee, and we found that there was really nothing of national security in the contents. So then we ruled that no, it must be released. And ultimately, the Cabinet at the time complied with that particular order, and the report was released to the appellants and really to the public. Now, the other issue has been where statistics are asked for. In many instances, the government comes to the commission and says no. These are national security matters. For example, the number of army camps in the north and east, or the number of rehabilitated liberation tigers of Tamil Kadu, so on and so forth. So in these instances, where the matter concerns data and does not concern or involve personal details of who the people are, where the camps are located, for example, we have ordered that these be released. And in almost all the instances, the public authorities have complied with these orders that have been handed down. So in terms of both of the national security exemption, these are some cases that I would like to refer to. Now, in terms of the cabinet memorandum, So here again, we have had several cases, particularly on procurement issues that come up to the commission, where they ask for the disclosure of cabinet memorandum, and we have actually used the public interest override in the act to order release. Now, the problem sometimes has been where documents are annexed to the cabinet memorandum, and those sometimes reflect on certain other tender procedures or details that may be a little bit problematic. So each case has been assessed individually, and then the orders have been given to release or redact, as the case may be, because the RTI Act has a provision whereby you can order part of the disclosure, a part of the information to be disclosed, and keep back the rest. So in the exemptions, we have been quite narrowly interpreting the application of that to the facts of the case in each instance. Now, basically, where sanctions are concerned, so the commission, as was remarked earlier, does not have the power to fine. It has, however, the power to criminally prosecute offending public authorities. And this was envisaged initially as a power to intimidate, as a power to make public authorities, in a sense, afraid of violating a rule of the commission, violating an order of the commission. So it was not envisaged really that the commission would go to court against, you know, millions and thousands and hundreds of public authorities. But there would have been a few cases in which perhaps the commission could have made a test prosecution of certain public authorities when they did not obey or adhere to the commission's orders, or perhaps more likely delayed. Because what we have found is that the public authorities, when they became accustomed to the Right Information Act and lost their fear of the act, they became more ready to, in a sense, delay, to give very rather inventive excuses as to why they cannot release the information. So in those instances, we could have gone to the court really against some of these public authorities. Unfortunately, COVID-19 pandemic broke out last year, tripled the functioning of the commission for almost half of last year, and very, very evidently this year as well. And the other issue in connection to this that I really want to point to is the importance of independent financial and administrative authority lines of the commission. In Sri Lanka, the Right to Information Commission is set up independently by virtue of the act, but somehow it so happened in practice that our financial allocations come from the nodal agency, from the ministry, which itself is a public authority. The Ministry of Media, which is a nodal agency, is itself a public authority. So there's a conflict of interest here, in a sense, because at one point the commission has to get financial allocations through the ministry. Another point, the ministry can appear before the commission as a public authority, as a respondent. So I think that should be corrected going forward. So now these are the challenges, in a sense, that we have faced in the last so many years. But on the whole, I think the use of the Right to Information Act in Sri Lanka and the obedience of the public authorities to the act has been quite significant and quite strong in the first 2.5 years of the act, and I think we should be happy about that. The only problem has been that the proactive disclosure of information in Sri Lanka is still quite weak, I think, as is the case in India, in Bangladesh, probably in Pakistan as well. Now, to me, RTI is not about forcing public authorities. You know, it's not about holding a stick or a public authority and saying, you know, you must obey this, otherwise you put into jail. It is about voluntary compliance. It is about persuading them that government moves better with RTI. And I think that truth has yet to be acknowledged by the public authorities in Sri Lanka and by the state as well. Now, the challenge that I can see going forward is to maintain the independence of the commission, is to maintain the independence of the Right to Information regime. And in a sense, though it has been done already, to try and bring the RTI into the public discourse in a more visible manner, so that the strongest defense to any attacks on RTI in the future will always be the people. If the people are silent, if the people say this is not a law that bothers us, or, you know, we are concerned about, then the political establishment at all times can interfere with the law, you know. So I think getting that forward is very important moving into the future. Thank you.